Hello world, it's Siraj, and YOLO, you only look once. That is the demo for today's video. We're gonna build an object detection algorithm called YOLO, you only look once, for real-time video. So you can feed this thing an AVI, an MOV, any kind of MP4 file, and it's gonna be able to, in real time, like this demo that you're seeing behind me that I'm running off of my laptop, in real time, be able to detect what objects are where. Now, this is one of the most popular and one of the most new techniques out there for object detection. So in this video, I'm gonna go over a little bit of the history of object detection techniques just over the past decade or so we can really see why YOLO is so impressive. Then I'm gonna go over the architecture of YOLO, and then at the end, we're gonna go through the code and we're gonna use it on both a pre-trained model and we're going to learn how to build our own YOLO model as well. Okay, so I hope you're excited for this, because I am, right? So let's get right on into it. So let's start off with some object detection history, starting from 2001. So in 2001, the first really good facial detection algorithm came out, and it was created by two guys, Paul Viola and Michael Jones. And so it was aptly named the Viola-Jones algorithm. And this was the first time that facial detection really worked for a webcam. And so, I mean, object detection has been around since the 60s. This is nothing new, right? But this was the first time that it really worked, better than anything else. And their algorithm did what all the other algorithms in general did before them. They hand-coded in features and fed them into a classifier, namely a support vector machine. So it was trained on a dataset of faces, right? And they would hand-code the location of eyes, of the mouth, of the nose, and then their relations to each other, right? So as great as it was at detecting faces, it was really bad at detecting faces in any other kind of configuration than what the hand-coded features said, right? So once they collected these features by hand, by manually, for each of these images, these features were vectors, right? And they would feed all these vectors together for a single image into a support vector machine, a classifier, right? A support vector machine can act as a linear classifier, a binary classifier, yes, no. And that was it, real face or not a real face. And this worked really well at the time. And here you can see some pseudocode of how it worked. But basically, for each of the images, they would downsample the image to create an image, which in this case is actually a feature, right? And then they would iteratively add all those features up together. They would concatenate them and then accumulate a series of filter outputs and feed all of those outputs to a support vector machine. If you want to know how support vector machines work, check out my Math of Intelligence playlist. Okay, so then in 2005, a much more efficient technique came out, still using features, hand-coded features, but it was called HOG, or histograms of oriented gradients. And it was invented by Navneet Dalal and Bill Triggs. So the basic idea of this algorithm was for every image, for faces, right? Namely, they applied it to faces, but they also applied it to pedestrian detection on roads, which is really useful, right? For self-driving cars, for traffic lights, for things like that. But the idea was, okay, you've got an image of a face, right? You've got an image of a face. And the goal is, how dark is the current pixel compared to all the surrounding pixels? So for every single pixel in an image, they would detect how dark it was compared to the surrounding pixels. And then they drew an arrow showing in which direction the image got darker, okay? And so they repeated that process for every single pixel in the image. So every pixel was then replaced by an arrow. And this arrow was called a gradient. Not a gradient in the sense of backpropagation for neural networks. A gradient, they're just using that word for this, right? So the gradients show the flow from light to dark across the entire image. So this is what a picture would eventually look like. It would go from a series of pixels, a matrix of pixels, into a matrix of gradients or arrows, which point which direction things are getting darker. And so then, once they had that, they broke up the image into small squares, 16 by 16 pixels each. And then in each square, they counted up how many gradients point in each major direction. And they replaced that square in the image with the arrow directions that were the strongest. So in that region, what direction was most prevalent, right? And they would replace the square in the image with arrows in that direction. And the end result of this is that the original image was converted into a simple representation presentation that looked like this. That was basically, it captured the essence of a face, right? And so they can use this image to then give it a new face. They can use some sort of similarity metric, like you know the Euclidean distance or any of the various distance metrics that we could use to detect how similar it was to whatever image it was given. And based on some threshold value, they could say, yes, this is a face, or no, this is not a face. So recall that this kind of basic feature map, right, that they've generated looks very similar to what convolutional nets learn themselves. But in this case, they had to hand code what this feature map looks like. So then in 2012, the era of deep learning began, right? This is when every so often in computer science, an idea comes along that just makes you not only rethink your existing ideas, but completely discard your existing ideas. And that's what deep learning was, right? So in 2012, for the ImageNet competition, this is a yearly competition to train for researchers to try to, you know, try out their algorithms and see who can outperform the other. Krichevsky and his team with Hinton used a convolutional network that outperformed everybody else for ImageNet, right? So for, this was in 2012. But the thing is that convolutional nets have been around since the 90s. Why did they work this time? If you can answer, you get bonus points. There are two reasons. It's because of lots of GPUs and lots of data. That's the difference. They gave it lots of computing power and lots of data. Now, the thing about humans, we're really good at classifying images, right? We're really good at this. But we do more than just classify images. So notice that whenever there's a classification task, yes or no, is it there or not? That's it, right? That's classification. Whenever there is a classification task, the images that we feed these models just have the class in question as the center of the image. Like if it's a dog, you'll just see a dog, maybe a white background, but it's just a dog. But the thing is, when we look around at the world, right, it's not just, we're not just classifying things, we are detecting things. That means that we are not just identifying what an object is, but we are classifying, but we're detecting the boundaries around that object, the differences of that object with the other objects in the images, and the relations between all the objects. So the question is, can convolutional nets, as great as they are at classification, also help at detection? That is, not just detecting whether or not an image is in a picture, right, as a single image, but detecting if that image exists, what its relation is to other images. Can we build a bounding box around that image? Is the image partially occluded, but we can still see it? Yes, the answer is yes, right? And this was proven by a team that was very recently, this was proven. But one very basic thing we can do is we can say, okay, let's take an existing convolutional net and repurpose it as an object detector. How are we gonna do that? Now, let me tell you how we're gonna do that. We can take any existing classifier, VGGNet, Inception, these are huge convolutional nets that were trained on huge data sets, right, by Google, et cetera. And what we can do is we can take our image in question, let's say it's this image here, and we want to detect a car. And VGGNet can obviously detect a car because it was trained on car images amongst many other classes. What we can do is we can slide the classifier over every single, over a bunch of squares of that image, right? So we can classify every single region as we define, maybe a 12 by 12 pixel region for every single one. And so as we're sliding it across the image, we're just continuously classifying every single box, right, of this image. We're gonna get a bunch of different classifications. We're gonna get a bunch of different classifications, and then we can only keep the ones that the classifier is the most certain about. And we can use that to then draw a bounding box around the image. But this is a very brute force-y approach, right? This is a very computationally expensive approach. We don't wanna just do that. That's dumb. That's not a good way. There's gotta be a more efficient way of doing things, right? So a better approach was invented just 2 years ago called RCNN, okay? So the idea behind RCNN was, before they fed it to a convolutional network, they would use a process called selective search to create a set of bounding boxes, or in the paper they call them region proposals, in an image. So at a high level, the selective search process looks at an image through a series of windows of different sizes, right? These are just randomly sized, randomly placed windows. And for each size, it tries to group together adjacent pixels by texture, color, or intensity to identify objects. So given some input image, the first step is to generate a set of region proposals for bounding boxes for however many we want by some threshold, right? And then once we have that, we run those images in the bounding boxes through a pre-trained AlexNet or whatever kind of CNN we want to compute the features for that bounding box. And then finally, a support vector machine to classify, to see what the object in the image in the box, what the object the image in the box is of. Then we run the box through a linear regression model to output tighter coordinates for the box once the object has been classified. And this proved to be an effective approach for object detection, the most effective, by repurposing a convolutional network for object detection by using this selective search algorithm to create bounding boxes beforehand, and then feeding all of those boxes to a CNN to compute a list of features, and then computing class values from them. So for RCNN, there have been lots of improvements, like lots. Fast RCNN, faster RCNN, mask RCNN, and I've got papers and links to them all here in the description. Actually, mask RCNN just came out this year. But YOLO, I think, is the best approach, and not just because of the name. YOLO is the best approach because it outperformed all of them. It outperformed RCNN and all of its variants that I know of. Maybe some guy just yesterday invented some new version of RCNN. I don't know. But as far as I know, YOLO is the state of the art in object detection. And YOLO takes a completely different approach, which is very exciting, right? So check this out. So what YOLO does is it's not a traditional classifier that's repurposed to be an object detector like RCNN. What it does is it actually just looks at the image once, hence its name, you only look once, but in a clever way. Let's say we've got this image, right? And what we want to do is detect all the classes that are in the image. We've got a dog, we've got a bike, we've got a car in the background. How are we going to do this? So what YOLO says is, let's divide up the image into a grid of 13 by 13 cells. And so each of these cells is responsible for predicting 5 bounding boxes. So some part of a bounding box is going to intersect into that little square right? So it's responsible for detecting up to 5 of them. Like it could be part of this one, part of this one, part of this one, part of this one, right? But 5. And so what a bounding box does is it describes the rectangle that encloses some object. YOLO is also going to output a confidence score that tells us how certain it is that the predicted bounding box actually encloses some object. So it's not just trying to predict it, whether or not a set of bounding boxes exist. It's also, each of these squares, is predicting what the class is for each of the bounding boxes that it's predicting the existence of. And so the score doesn't say anything about what kind of object is in the box, just if the shape of the box is any good. So the predicting bounding boxes may look something like the following. The higher the confidence score, the fatter the box that is drawn. So notice, for our doggy, for our bike, we've got some really thick bounding boxes, meaning that it can tell that there is something significant there. So each of the bounding boxes, for each bounding box, the cell also predicts a class, right? It's predicting two things, whether or not a bounding box exists, and then the class of that bounding box. And this works just like a classifier. It gives a probability distribution over all the possible classes that the network has been trained on. It's a convolutional network. So YOLO was trained on the Pascal VOC dataset, which has 20 different classes like bicycles and boats and cars and dogs. And the confidence score for the bounding box and the class prediction are combined into one final score that tells the probability that this bounding box contains a specific type of object. For example, the big fat yellow box here on the left is 85% sure that it contains the object dog. So based on some kind of threshold value, like 80% plus, we can just leave that bounding box there that we decide. So since there are 13 by 13 grid cells and each cell is predicting 5 bounding boxes, we end up with 845 bounding box boxes in total. That's a lot of bounding boxes. But it turns out that most of these boxes are gonna have very low confidence scores. So we only keep the boxes whose final score is 30% or more, like I said, whatever threshold value we want. And once we do that, the end result is gonna be this. We're gonna have only 3 bounding boxes left. And these 3 bounding boxes had scores that were higher than our threshold value, 30%. And as you can see, that's exactly what we wanted to detect. But the key here, the secret of why YOLO is so good, is because it's not just that from the 845 total bounding boxes, we only kept 3 of them, but it's that even though there were 845 separate predictions, they were all made at the same time, right? YOLO, you only look once. The convolutional network is only looking once. We are feeding all of these boxes to the neural network all at once, right? So it is a convolutional network, right? And the architecture is very, very simple. This is what it looks like, right? You've got input, convolution, pooling, right? Over and over and over again. And there are actually several versions of YOLO out there. There's YOLO, and then there's YOLO V2, also called YOLO 9000, better, faster, stronger. I know, these names are just going crazy. I love it though. Memes and signs together, win, total win, right? So this is what it looks like. And so, by the way, we're gonna be looking at YOLO 2, just skip YOLO 1, because YOLO 2 is obviously better. What we're gonna do is once we feed our bounding boxes into our convolutional network, we're gonna end up with 125 channels for every single grid cell. And these 125 numbers contain the data for the bounding boxes and the class predictions. And the reason it's 125 is because each grid cell predicts 5 bounding boxes, and a bounding box is described by 25 data elements. And these are the elements, the X, Y, that's the locations, the coordinates, the width and height for the bounding boxes, right? Rectangle, the confidence score, and the probability distribution over the classes. Using it is very simple. You give it an input image, right? It goes through the convolutional network in a single pass, and it comes out the other end as a 13x13x125 sized tensor describing the bounding boxes for the grid cells. And all you need to do then is compute the final scores for the bounding boxes and throw away the ones that are scoring less than 30%. And so YOLO 2 is better because it's faster, it understands more generalized object representations, and you can find a paper for it here. Okay, so what I want to do now is go through some code. So let's go through some code. This is probably the best implementation of YOLO 2 that I found on GitHub so far. So originally, the authors of YOLO wrote it in this darknet. So darknet is an open source neural network library in C. I know, why didn't they just use TensorFlow? But they wrote it in darknet, and it's written for C and CUDA. It's fast, it's great. If you want to work with C, work with C. But basically the best implementation I found is called DarkFlow. So what this guy did is he translated darknet to a TensorFlow version. And we can use DarkFlow to do several things, and I'm gonna do it with you right now, okay? Let's get started here, right? So we can choose one of the following 3 ways to get started with DarkFlow. I've downloaded it here, so you can just clone it locally, and then you can set it up. So the first step is to run setup.py. No module named Cython. Okay, so then I'll install Cython. Okay, so that's the first step. We're gonna set up Cython, and once it's done that, then we can install all of our dependencies. And the reason we're using Cython is because, right, darknet is written in C, and we need some kind of wrapper to introduce these C libraries to our Python environment. So now I can go ahead and install all our dependencies. That'll take some time. Okay, that was it. That was our dependencies. And so now let's go ahead and let's download some weights. Okay, so I downloaded these pre-trained weights, and I'm going to open them. TinyYOLO weights. Right here. Okay. Now I want to load these weights up. Okay, so let's look at this code for a bit. All right, so for the code, we can see that it is quite a big project, but if we look under net, we're gonna see some of the versions of the different YOLO implementations. So we can just go to, let's see where we can go to. We can go to YOLO v2. Okay, so if we go to build.py, we can see the TensorFlow implementation of darknet. So remember, because this was written in C, we are not using TensorFlow native functions to build this convolutional network. So when we go into the init function, we'll see that yes, there are some, you know, boilerplate flags for how to train this network. And there are different ways of building this network. We can build it from a pre-trained PB file. You know, that's how we save files in TensorFlow as .pb. That's one of the ways. And when we build the forward pass, like this is kind of where the convolutional network is built. We have some placeholder that the input data can go through. That is namely the image or the video, whatever it is. And then iteratively, they're taking all the author took the existing darknet layers and they're adding them to TensorFlow, just like right here. Okay, so, and then we have a bunch of flags and then we have a way to save the file once we've trained it. So, but the basic idea is that we can use a pre-trained version of this model that was trained in C by downloading weights and then using the train.py file to train it on our video or on our images. And then lastly, we can then predict what the bounding boxes are going to be by using predict.py class, right? Okay, so there are several things we can do. We can train our model using our own data set. We can use pre-trained weights. We can train it on images. We can train it on video. But for this demo, why don't we just use a pre-trained model that they already have, right? The author has weights that we can download. And then we can train it on one of our own videos, right? So if I just paste this in, we can train it on one of our own videos, and then we can see the results for ourselves. All right, just like that. And so now this is detecting all the objects in the video using YOLO. It's awesome. And yeah, if you wanna do this yourself, it's pretty simple. I've got the code, the description, the slides that I was talking about. Everything is in the video description in the GitHub link. So check them out and I hope that you found this useful. Please subscribe for more programming videos. And for now, I've got to think of some YOLO memes. So thanks for watching.